Hi. So sometimes movie studios, instead of coming up with an original idea, will opt to adapt intellectual properties from other mediums of entertainment like books, TV series, theme park rides, board games, toys, video games, fucking emojis. And more often than not, these properties simply don't make for very good movies. And like, yeah, it's no surprise that a Garbage Pail Kids movie's bad, but even movies based on books don't have the best track record. And perhaps that's because this whole time, Hollywood's been ignoring what it should really be adapting into movies. Not books, not video games, but whatever Chuck E. Cheese is. An arcade? A pizzeria? Both? It's both. Chuck E. Cheese in the Galaxy 5000 is a direct-to-video movie from 1999, and it's weird, man. Also, sorry, the copy that I'm using of this movie isn't of the best quality. It's what I could find. Anyway, the video opens with Chef Pasquale welcoming us into Chuck E. Cheese.
Welcome. Welcome to my famous eatery. Come on in, my little friends. Come join us.
You know, I've always thought if making fun of Italians and doing an exaggerated Italian accent ever became as socially taboo as it is to do that with other ethnicities, we're fucked. We're all canceled. I'm canceled. You're canceled. Yeah! Mario's canceled. But hey, while it is socially acceptable, Mamma Mia, forget about it, hey! We're then introduced to Chucky and his friends, Helen Henny the chicken, Jasper Jowls the dog, and Mr. Munch, who's not a particular animal like the others, he's just a nondescript purple character. What I find weird is, like Chuck E. Cheese, the cast of McDonald's characters are all identifiable as animals and food items, and then there's just Grimace, who's also nondescript purple creature.
How do you do it? What's your secret?
Why is that a pattern? All the way down to them both being purple.
Wow, if I had a nickel for every time I-
Restaurant chain's group of mascot characters were all easily identifiable species apart from one who's an undefined purple creature.
I'd have two nickels, which isn't a lot, but it's weird that it happened twice, right?
Pasquale then introduces the gang to a boy named Charlie who needs money because, as he puts it,
it's for my aunt and uncle. See, they're farmers. Their tractor's engine blew up and, like, it's harvest time. And they're in a terrible fix because my dad says it'll take $50,000 to buy a new tractor.
How are we going to get that kind of money?
We'll think of, something.
But what I'm wondering is why are they so willing to help this Charlie kid whom they just met with such a big task? Maybe Charlie saw something he wasn't supposed to, like proof that that conspiracy about Chuck E. Cheese recycling pizzas is true. And Chucky knows that if Charlie doesn't get his money, he'll expose them. Jasper suggests that they get jobs to raise the money.
Oh, we could all get jobs. You know, I saw a help wanted sign down at the Chicken Palace.
I don't think so.
Jasper, now you've done it. What?
Oh.
Oops.
Oh, where do humans get off anyway, eating poor little defenseless birds? Are they crazy? Where would they be without their eggs for breakfast every morning? And how do they repay us? By giving us the deep fry? Oh.
Helen's tantrum about eating chicken here is weird, considering that today, Chuck E. Cheese, you know, her home, serves wings. So, Chucky asks Pasquale if he has any ideas about raising money.
I'm glad you asked that question, Chucky. In a few days, a big race is gonna take a place. Look.
The Galaxy 5000 is an interplanetary race on the planet Orion.
I love how in movies, the TV is always playing exactly what the plot needs it to. Like, realistically, wouldn't it have been on a different channel at first?
Look.
It's Morbin time.
Pasquale informs the group of a race called the Galaxy 5000, where the prize money would be enough for a new tractor. But he also explains how dangerous the race is, and the gang is hesitant.
I don't blame any of you if you don't want to go. on this emissione.
Sorry, Charlie.
Sorry, Charlie.
It's okay. I understand.
Now, I know what you've been thinking this whole time. This Chuck E. Cheese movie is so close to cinematic perfection, I just wish it were a musical. Well, wish granted.
Come on, everybody, think it's time we get together and get our toes a-tapping.
Did you know that Stephen Sondheim wrote the songs for this? One of his lesser-known works.
So come along with me, your buddy Chuck E. Cheese. I'd like to be your captain if you climb in the adventure machine.
Also, this girl is dressed as a minion like 10 years before Despicable Me came out. You know, it's said that God will give us signs before the coming of the Messiah. The song convinces everyone to participate in the race, and from this point forward, the movie is shot almost entirely on green screens with really primitive CGI backgrounds. A lot like Sharkboy and Lava Girl or Spy Kids, but somehow even worse looking. The group uses a teleportation machine to get to the race, and a flirtation between Chucky and Helen is established.
Oh. Ooh. Hi.
Ooh, Chucky.
Excuse me while I try not to wonder how a rat and a chicken could fuck. It's here we're first introduced to Peter and Ivan, rival racers known as the X-Pilots. They're these two guys doing like vague Arnold Schwarzenegger impressions and
we have a superior training program
resulting in maximum buffness.
Yeah. You said it.
Yeah.
I hate them. And as if I wasn't uncomfortable enough with the thought of Chucky and Helen getting together, these guys flirt with her too.
Hey, look at the pretty chicky.
Yeah.
Hey, chicky, how would you like to roost at our pad?
Yeah.
She's a chicken. How could you look at this and feel even the slightest bit of sexual attraction? Okay, I mean, I kind of get it. So some plot happens. They find Pasquale's old racing partner, Flapjack, who's like a cowboy, and he has a ship for them called the Songbird. Then a human woman named Astrid comes by, and not only does she start flirting with Chucky, but he's into it.
Oh, I can't wait to see it. Race car drivers are so cool.
Don't worry, I got it.
No, I got it.
Hey, I beg your pardon.
They couldn't have made this love interest for Chucky another mouse, or at least another animal? Was there not enough in the budget for one more mascot costume? Chucky plans a date with Astrid after the race, which angers Helen, and the Charlie kid has a line.
Wonder what's ruffling her feathers.
How should I know? I'm not old enough to have figured out girls.
I don't think anybody lives that long.
I forgot he was here. He's barely said anything. Helen then sings a ballad about her unrequited love for Chucky.
Why can't he see the real me? He doesn't even know who I am.
And it's not funny at all. There aren't any attempts at jokes in the lyrics, which makes me think we're supposed to like take it semi-seriously, which is a big ask considering it's an anthropomorphic chicken singing about an anthropomorphic rat. We transition to the next day, and before the race starts, there's a shot of a large crowd, which is just a small group of people copy-pasted like 5 times. The race then begins and all the ships, including the Songbird, take off.
But can we just pull over? I gotta go potty!
No, you're gonna have to hold it, you big furball.
Oh. Whoa, you can't call him furball when you're a dog. That'd be like me calling someone a loser while I'm making a video about a Chuck E. Cheese movie. They catch up to Peter and Ivan, who engage in foul play.
Look out!
Ah!
Yeah!
No, I'm kidding, they're fine. The X-Pilots then activate something called Zoom Gas, which like makes them high.
Here comes the juice! Yeah, the Zoom's good!
So I guess this was like a practice race or just the first round, because Chucky loses and then goes to the soda shop with Astrid, but they're talking about how the race isn't until the next day.
Well, you'll get it figured out before the big race tomorrow, won't you, Chucky?
I don't understand it, but it also doesn't really matter. Helen then shows up with Peter and Ivan to make Chucky jealous, and can we stop with the interspecies relationships? Please? Jesus, and I thought the Ninja Turtles were bad.
Oprah, I've been trying to talk her into an interspecies relationship for months now.
Whoa, chill, man.
And she won't do it, huh?
She can't
hold her breath.
The biggest problem is she can't hold her breath long enough, you know?
Jasper then sings a song where Munch holds a CGI ice cream cone.
Well, we might just save some face. We got a snowball's chance in Texas to win this race.
The X-Pilots bring Helen to the lab of their mentor, Dr. Zoom, and they let it slip that they use Zoom gas.
And we use a lot of Zoom gas.
Zoom gas? What's Zoom gas?
Zoom gas? There's no such thing.
Yeah, there is no such thing. That's what Dr. Zoom told us to say.
I thought so. You guys are cheating. There is such a thing as Zoom gas.
No!
Okay, so I guess the Zoom gas is like cheating. It's like the equivalent of steroids for this race. God, that's stupid.
Yeah! Yeah! No!
No?
Yeah! Yeah! No!
No!
Yeah!
Yeah?
No!
No!
Yeah! Yeah! Yeah!
Yeah!
No!
No!
Dr. Zoom then reveals himself and starts singing a song about the Zoom gas. And in all honesty, the guy that plays Dr. Zoom is like a really talented singer.
Yes. It's one of the kind,
Zoom gas.
The others will find,
Zoom gas,
that you leave them behind.
Sorry, did I say talented? I meant, you know, the opposite of that. Also, his name is Dr. Zoom, and he uses Zoom juice. Did he name it after himself, or did he change his name after discovering it for a brand synergy? Zoom says he needs to hold Helen captive now that he knows about their performance enhancers.
I'm afraid, my dear, that I can't let you go. As the saying goes, loose lips sink ships.
But Helen is a chicken. She doesn't have lips.
But I don't have lips.
Whoa, hey, let me do my fucking job, okay? Chucky then practices racing through the canyon again and crashes before waking up in the cave of a Scottish hermit named Harry, who's played by the same actor as Pasquale.
Who are you? You really look familiar.
And there's no plot explanation for this, by the way. He's not like Pasquale's identical cousin or anything. I'm guessing they just didn't want to pay an additional actor. Also, there's an error here where Chucky and Harry talk over each other.
You need to learn the art of realizing your true potential.
Will that work?
I should nearly every time.
How did that even happen when all of Chucky's dialogue is ADR? Harry then trains Chucky over the course of a song. Back at the soda parlor, Chucky's friends are worried about him, but Astrid only seems to care about him returning in time for the race.
Well, so how's he going to race for me?
Well, right now we're just hoping he's okay.
Great, just great.
And now that Astrid has revealed her true intentions, I can tell you that in this movie's Wikipedia plot summary, the fact that Astrid's only interested in the prize money is highlighted. And clicking it takes you to the Wikipedia page for Gold Digger. I don't know, I just found that really funny. So with Chucky missing, Astrid leaves with Peter and Ivan.
Huh, who'd have figured?
Not me.
Jasper, this must be one of those girl things again, huh?
That's me when I tried watching Euphoria. We then cut to Helen imprisoned with a bunch of regular chickens.
It's okay, girls. Be patient, I'll get us out.
And I'm sorry, but I just don't have the energy to unpack the implications of that. But she escapes just in time to see Chucky and the gang off to the final race.
Oh,
hey,
Chucky.
Helen!
Oh, Chucky, I didn't really like those guys. I was just trying to figure out if they were cheating.
Oh, it's okay, Helen. I never lost faith in you.
And I hate to be anticlimactic, but there's just, like, not much to say about the end of this movie. Chucky wins the race, Dr. Zoom, Peter, and Ivan are arrested, and since this is a kids' movie from 1999, it ends in a big dance party.
Jump to the sky, laugh, all our cares away, we feel so right that we could fly.
And sorry to disappoint, but I checked, and there's no post-credits scene where Ronald McDonald shows up to tell Chucky he's putting a team together. And I would tell you my thoughts on it, but in this movie's YouTube comment section, there's a comment from the user Starburst who just perfectly articulates how this movie made me feel, so I think I'm just gonna read that. This is the best piece of content I've ever had the joy of witnessing. Before this, I was lost. I was living life with a blindfold over my eyes. After seeing this movie, my life has a new purpose. A new meaning, to worship the very hot chicken. I love everything about this movie. This movie is an innovative masterpiece, the likes of which I've never witnessed before, with the best graphical effects ever unveiled to mankind. My life has completely changed. I am finally happy, joyful even. I can feel myself ascending.